got up, of course, before dawn, getting our to get prepared.
And as dawn started to break, we could see the island, just see the image of the island out in front of us.
Iwo looked like an island that had been fortified heavily.
I had my 19th birthday on Iwo Jima. You don't understand all the things about life when you're that young yet, but you learn fast.
I was scared. Damn right I was scared.
And at my age, I just considered myself being invincible.
As originally they had told us, it was only going to be a 72-hour operation. It's a traumatic feeling on a landing craft going into a beach that's occupied by the enemy.
One of the saddest things was, even before we left the ship to go ashore, they was already bringing casualties on. And that is very disheartening.
We had a constant stream of boats going back and forth with wounded from the beach into the various hospital ships and the APAs that were out there taking care of them. There were a tremendous number of wounded with that outfit.
We landed with 257 in F Company. After 36 days, there was 27 of us left. The rest were casualties.
When I came back on the same line, they were still there. But they were no longer alive.
All of us who lived feel guilty. Excuse me.
That was probably the highlight of my life.
That's something I'll never forget. Yeah. You know, a young man, I never seen nothing like this, you know.
The cost for Iwo Jima was tremendous. There's no two ways about it, but it also shortened the war.
And for the past 60 years, there isn't a day goes by that I don't think about it.
I think this country is wonderful. Well, I can't say enough.
Freedom is expensive. And when you look at lives, you have to agree.
This is your number one enemy, your favorite playmate, Orphan Anne, a radio soldier. The little sunbeam whose throat you'd like to touch. We're ready again for a vicious assault on your morale.
While we're having our coffee and donuts, the ship's radio was picking up Tokyo Rose's broadcasts. And I'll never forget her words. Welcome, men of the 5th Marine Division, to Iwo Jima.
When we left Guam, we had no idea where we were going. Iwo Jima was a new name for us.
We didn't find out that we were going to Iwo Jima until we left Saipan.
They never tell you anything about it until you're aboard ship and at sea.
We didn't know why we were going to Iwo Jima. We never heard of it.
I never even knew it existed till I was there.
It looked like an island out of this world. It looked like something from space or something, because there was no vegetation or anything on it. What little there was, the Navy blew off of it, so.
Now, the island of Iwo Jima, I always referred to it as a piece of dirt, and that's what it was, a piece of dirt. It was shaped like a pork chop, an aerial view, and of course there was this infamous Mount Suribachi.
Suribachi dominates the island, dominates your view of the island, and no doubt we expected that the Japanese headquarters would be in it.
Well, the day before, we got the pictures of what the beach looked like and the new positions that had been discovered from the latest bombing run. And then we found out that the Air Force had been bombing Iwo Jima for 72 days.
They had a lot of people underground, and they were just not susceptible to heavy bombing.
All I knew was there were about 20,000 Japanese there. And we had trouble trying to figure out how we're going to get up Mount Suribachi.
Iwo looked like an island that had been fortified heavily. But the reality of it is that it was a fortress that looked like an island. Because from one end to the other, you didn't have, the map will show you lines of the enemy defenses, but that isn't the reality. It was defense in depth. You never broke through and then they collapsed. That did not happen.
Kiribayashi, as we understood it, had told his men, you take 10 Americans for every one Japanese and we can be successful.
Initially, we didn't feel as though it was going to be that bad, but the fact that the island was really aflame and the smoke didn't feel as though it was going to be too difficult.
I said, so it can't be much. It's a small island, only 8 square miles. What kind of problem can there be in a small island like that? And there are only 5,000 Japanese soldiers there. Well, we found out that there were 22 or 23,000 Japanese soldiers.
When we did hit it, they thought we could take it in 72 hours. That was the general consensus.
We were told that the whole operation would take about 3 to 5 days.
And we've been led to believe that because of the tremendous pre-invasion naval bombardment and the bombardment by the United States Air Corps, that there'd be few, if any, Japanese left on the island, and those who may be left would be so shell-shocked, so to speak, that they would not be able to resist us. And we really believed it when they said it would be a 3 to 5 day operation.
Originally, the Navy was going to shell the island for 10 days, and they cut it down to 3 days, which caused a lot of problems. But the Air Force bombed Iwo Jima for 72 consecutive days, and it did absolutely no, had no effect whatsoever. Everything was underground.
Every aspect of that island's terrain was exploited in the most feasible way of inflicting damage on us.
Yeah, they pretty much thought that it was going to be an easy operation. They didn't realize how badly, I guess, the Japanese were dug in.
Because originally they had told us it was only going to be a 72-hour operation. But there was a lot they didn't know about the Japanese, who were completely underground.
I had my 19th birthday on Iwo Jima. And on March the 21st, and we got off the island on March the 26th.
My 19th birthday was spent aboard ship.
And I knew I celebrated my 21st birthday on the island of Iwo Jima.
18 years was the average age at Iwo, meaning more men were 18 than were not.
You don't understand all the things about life when you're that young yet, but you learn fast.
And my men said to me, Lieutenant, you promised that we would be going. Like kids, you know, and they were. They were 18 years old, but they became men very quickly.
And at my age, I just considered myself being invincible.
I don't think you ever think you're going to die.
I don't think anybody ever felt they were going to get hit. I mean, we all thought that we were, safe, that we were going to be safe and so forth.
I had made two previous D-Day landings, and I knew what was coming up. I guess at that age, you're a little bit invincible, you feel like.
Well, the night before we landed, we were on LSTs. We traveled on LSTs all over the Pacific. We had come from Guam. It took about 3 days, I think it was, from Guam to get to Iwo. And the whole convoy rendezvoused during the night off of Iwo.
Listening and watching the bombardment of the island, and Just wondered what was in there and what we was going to get into.
The thinking was really, how were you going to survive this?
This is my first battle. I'm an optimistic soul, and I heard people walking the decks, and it occurred to me the old timers know what's ahead. I don't.
You don't very well do much sleeping the night before because you're thinking about it. You never know whether you'll come back or not. So, but you just hope you do.
But you really don't think of what's going to happen to you, okay? Because you're too involved in the task that's in front of you.
Most of the fellas were accepted what was about to happen.
I was scared. Damn right I was scared.
Oh, absolutely. Everybody was scared, but they also knew they had to do something, and you don't let your buddies down.
I had no idea, and I wasn't prepared for what I was going to face on the island.
Everybody is pretty much their own thoughts, trying to think of what's going to happen, what they're going to do.
I think to describe most of all, it was quiet. I think each man was lost in his own thoughts about what's going to happen when we hit that beach. Am I going to make it? Am I going to come out of this battle alive?
And I looked around and I wondered, who is going to be here tomorrow night?
I would say the morale was very high. Nobody came wavering or indicating any serious fear. They had respect for and the sense of obligated duty to God, to country, and being a great Marine. To the imminent danger that death is very uncertain. It can happen to the young and to the old. We know not the day nor the hour. As we are ready as Marines, we are to be ready as soldiers of Jesus Christ. I had mass up on the forecastle, and they were crowded all over. There's a picture there of the troop ship. They were up on the gun mounts and so on and so forth. So I gave a talk, which just came naturally, I guess. I said, now, men, this was at the end of Mass, you have nothing to worry about, nothing to be afraid. Today you received Holy Communion at this Mass. When we hit that beach, God will be with you, and you have nothing to be afraid of.
But the Marines, every man for himself and God for us all. So that means, hey, trust in God that you come back alive.
I believe it was the skipper's voice, the Navy skipper's voice, came over and said, halt, or words to that effect. He says, we're going to have a prayer by the chaplain. And the chaplain recited the 23rd Psalm. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And once again, those words sent a chill up our spine. When the prayer was over, then down the cargo net and into the landing craft.
We got up, of course, before dawn, getting our to get prepared, and we had a very early breakfast, which was a joy because we never had steak and eggs before.
We had our final meal of steak and eggs, and that's rather traditional in the Marine Corps.
They had us up about 4 a.m. They fed us steak for breakfast. We slipped a few sandwiches in our pockets to take in with us.
We went down to chow. And the amphibian tractors were all in the hold there.
And as dawn started to break, we could see the island, just see the image of the island out in front of us. And as it got lighter, the Navy fighter planes and bombers started coming in, making their runs.
And then as the sun came up, then looming out in the water was our target, Iwo. And it was just all smoke, all ablaze, and we could see the our bombers taking their runs, and you could see the explosions of their bombs, and of course the Navy ships, the gunships, offshore, while they were also laying down their last barrage, I guess you could call it. Anyway, after breakfast, we got all our gear together and went topside, waiting for the order to go down the cargo nets.
We had nets that were aboard ship that we climbed down nets into the landing craft, which would take us on into the beach.
It's kind of a sickening feeling as you get up there and put your hand on the edge of the net, the cargo net that we had to go down to get into some of the boats.
One of the thrills of your lifetime is going down a cargo net to get into a landing craft with a pack on your back and a medical accessory bag on the side of that.
And yes, and the boats, the Higgins boats going up and down like this, and the ship is going like this, and you got to coordinate going down that rope that you don't get caught between the ship and the Higgins boat.
Several people fell. I mean, it wasn't unusual to see people fall into the boat, and the boat's down there going like this, and everything else is.
Once you're down the ladder and into the boats, they float in formation until they get the go. And when they get the go, they elongate into a single file abreast and go.
Each landing craft heads to what we call rendezvous point. And as each landing craft gets to rendezvous point, it becomes an ever-widening circle.
Well, in Higgins' boat, first you go to an assembly area called a line of departure, or just behind it, and you go in a circle with the boats that are going in, which are usually five or six at a time. And then when the command comes for you or for anybody else, you go line up at the line of departure, and then you drop a flag that you can see, and then off we go.
We had just had our eyes peeled on that that small boat out there that had flags on it, and we knew what our flag was, and as soon as they ran our flag up and dropped it, that means go.
And as more landing craft join, the wider the circle gets. And then the word comes from the command ship to head for the beach, and what was a circle now becomes a wave as it just stretches out. And now you've got wave after wave after wave.
So when we went to the island, we had that feeling, piece of cake, that was all we were talking about. And we went in under the guns of the battleships. We could feel the heat of the guns over our heads as we went in. And as we got to very close to the islands, actually. We were near Suribachi, not too far. We were on the Green Beach. Suribachi was on Green Beach. And we got closer and closer. And
all of a sudden, all the boats straightened out, and they all headed at one time toward the beach.
Nobody much talked to anybody. Pretty much everybody, we just had their own thoughts going in. We'd done it before, figured it was much the same.
Very quiet. I mean, very quiet. Everybody was thinking what's going to happen.
It's pretty quiet. Nobody's saying much. The sergeant of the platoon is kind of guiding us a little bit and telling us when we hit the beach and what to do to keep down and so forth.
Get to shore, get the hell off of that boat and move, you know. And because you got your platoon sergeant telling you, you know, hey, this is it, you know, we're going.
We have to be ready because we're going into combat.
And when you go under fire, I don't care what they say, you have butterflies in your stomach and you're nervous.
The Japanese knew we were coming, and they were ready, and they got prepared.
The minute we passed the line of departure and the ramp went down, the sunshine was gone. You were under a cloud of smoke.
It's a traumatic feeling on a landing craft going into a beach that's occupied by the enemy.
I mean, the closer we got, and finally the naval bombardment stopped because our first wave was ready to hit, you know.
And as we got closer to the beach, of course, enemy fire was coming in on us and hitting some of the landing craft.
But when you see a boat with probably maybe 25 or 30 Marines in her take a direct hit, you know, and you know, that makes you think, you know, this is for real, you know.
You're told to lock and load your piece, and then you get down. This time you hunker down, and they drop the ramp, and away you go.
No, we just hit the beach, and the
the ramp drop down and just try and go.
When he strikes the sand for the first time, down goes the ramp and off we go.
And we went ashore and he dropped the front of it and he said, get out.
And as we hit the beach, and one of the main sayings we had is clear the beach, get off the beach.
Opened the ramp, we went out in 4 or 5 feet of water. That's no way to fight a war soaking wet.
Our LCVP could not get into the shore, and we had to drop the ramp and get out. We were in water up to about my chest, hold our rifles up above us, and get to the beach the best way we could.
And when we hit that beach, we knew we were in trouble.
It wasn't until we hit shore that it finally dawned us what we were getting into.
As we sailed in to the shore, I happened to be in the second wave to go in, and it was somewhat of a, maybe today you might refer to it as a traumatic experience to find what was waiting for us on the beach.
The beachmaster's job was to make sure, or to try to make sure to keep the beach clear so that they wouldn't just have boats wrecked all over the beach and the ships that you needed to get in couldn't get in.
It was very quiet when we hit the beach. Not entirely quiet. There was sporadic gunfire.
They allowed us to land without much fire to start with.
But this Japanese general, Kuribayashi, his plan was to leave the first five waves in and get the beach as congested as possible, and then open up with all of his mortar and artillery. As it turned out, wave after wave coming in, the third, fourth waves were catching up with the first and second waves. And this is what the Japanese wanted. They wanted it to get it all congested there and then open up with their artillery and their mortar.
One Navy individual who's known as the beach master, he rides parallel to the shore, seeing what's happening, and with his bullhorn, he was yelling, "Get the hell off the beach!"
When we came ashore, there's a rise of about 30, 35 feet, and it's all volcanic ash.
The beach was not sand; it was volcanic ash, and actually, to walk on the volcanic ash, you sank up to your ankles. It was just like walking in snow.
The black sand of the beach was a stark contrast to any sand I'd ever seen before. It was a very loose sand so that you sunk into it as you would walk along. So that meant it was hard to advance or to advance quickly.
There were a series of three terraces from the beach up to the first airfield. And it was all volcanic ash, and it was so thin that the amphibs just sunk in it.
As we left the landing craft, we advanced a few yards, and then there was a what can best be described as a terrace. All right, we call it the first terrace. And after you went up this first terrace, there was a plateau for several yards, and then there was another terrace.
The beach was covered with men. I mean, lying in up against it's a terrace. Landing area. The beach was terraced up this way.